The correct answer here is choice C, pleomorphagenoma of the parotid gland. So you heard this spell before. Radiology is about real estate. It's like location, location, location. So it's important to try to localize the lesion based on the space. So for CT neck, there are three deep fascial layer. Each individual layer, including superficial layer, middle layer, and the deep layer. The superficial layer forms the masticator space. Neck space is formed by three different layers, such as the carotid space. So it's important to identify this neck spaces for your board exam to know centrally that you have a parapharyngeal space, and that's surrounded by masticator space, carotid space, and the pharyngeal mucosal space, or retropharyngeal space, perivertebral space surrounding the spine, and the posterior cervical space. It's important to know each space because the pathology likes to stay within a given space. Unless the lesion is very, very aggressive or a lesion is a congenital finding, usually they don't cross into different spaces. If you know a lesion is derived from a given space, for example, from masticator space, you know the major content of the masticator space contains, for example, muscles. So you may have a lesion derived from the muscle, such as sarcoma, mandible, the bony lesions, osteomyelitis, sarcoma of the bone, as well as trigeminal nerve, so schwannoma could be derived from this space in some small vessel. So you don't expect to see a disease process that's related to, for example, lymph node, because it does not usually contain lymph node within this space. For the parotid space, the majority of the content is going to be fat, so it's not the most interesting space, but it does contain a small nerve and minor salivary gland. But what's useful about parapharyngeal fat is that, depending on which way it's been compressed and displaced, you can sort of guesstimate as to where the lesion is coming from. For example, if a parapharyngeal fat has been displaced laterally, so chances are it's coming from the mucosal space. If it's been displaced anteriorly, chances are the lesion is coming from the carotid space. Things that you would not expect from the parapharyngeal space. Because it does not contain muscle or lymph node, you don't anticipate sarcoma or lymphoma coming from this particular space. Parotid space, surprise, surprise, contains parotid gland. And it does contain lymph node, which I highlighted right here. Remember, parotid gland is one of the salivary glands that incorporates lymph node within. So a nodal disease such as lymphoma or nodal metastasis can be derived from the parotid space. Another concept of node is that the notice parotid gland has a superficial lobe and a deep lobe, and the deep lobe extends very deeply abutting the parapharyngeal space. So the concept of the stylomandibular ligament or stylomandibular tunnel is that if you have a tumor that's coming from the parotid space, that it may burrow through this space right here, and that was sandwiched between the stylomandibular ligament or styloid process and laterally of the mandible, the so-called stylomandibular tunnel. So if a lesion that's derived from the parotid gland, chances are you will expand this distance between the styloid process and the mandible. On the other hand, if you notice that the styloid process is being pushed anteriorly or the stylomandibular tunnel is narrow, then you should start to think about the lesion may come in from the carotid space rather than from the parotid space. So those are the major neck spaces that you should know for board exam. Back to our case. The first thing that we need to decide is which space is this lesion coming from. On CT, the soft tissue boundary is difficult to determine. Therefore, it's hard to tell the difference between the boundary of the lateral pterygoid muscle, right here, and the lesion itself. It's reasonable to assume that this may be a masticator space. The soft tissue is much better seen on MRI, as you know. And on this post-contrast T1 weighted sequence, you can see the lateral pterygoid muscle and the lesions clearly separated. The lateral pterygoid muscle has been pushed. Therefore, this is not the masticator space lesion. And also on CT, you can tell that, and you can tell that better on MRI. You can see a nice preservation of the fat plane between the pharyngeal mucosal space and the lesion itself, as demonstrated by this T1 bright fat. So you know that this is not nasopharyngeal squamous cell carcinoma. So you can already eliminate it, choice B and choice D. What about carotid space? Well, for the carotid space, you can sense that the vessels, the internal carotid arteries, the internal jugular vein, it's been pushed backwards. Rather than a carotid space lesion, that should expand either the vessels, so in the opposite direction, or push the vessels more interiorly. So you know that this is not choice A, vagal nerve schwannoma, which is coming from the carotid space. Lastly, we already talked about that the lesion or the parapharyngeal space does not contain lymph node, so therefore this is not a nodal pathology. A lot of lesion that seems like occupying the parapharyngeal space is actually derived from outside of the parapharyngeal space rather than natively coming from the parapharyngeal space, containing mostly just fat. Icing on the cake is that if you notice that the distance between the styloid process of the mandible, the stylomandibular tunnel, is being widened compared to the other side, there's a good chance this is coming from the deep lobe of the parotid gland. By process of elimination, choice C is the correct answer. Now, what can they ask you on the board exam about pleomorphic adenoma itself? It's also known as benign mixed tumor. It's a low-grade lesion. It is also by far the most common parotid neoplasm, accounted for 70 to 80% of the time. It is bright on T2. It is said that brighter it is on T2, more chance that it will be benign. Of course, that's the oversimplification. And also the lesion, the buzzword description of its shape, not very well demonstrated in this case. Lesion is basilated or basilation of the lesion. For those of you who are wondering what a basilation or basilated lesion look like, this is a picture of a sugar apple that I grew up eating it as a kid in Taiwan. It has this lobulator surface, and that's basilation. And even though this lesion is benign, there is a small chance of malignant transformation. So when a lesion gets to a certain size, that while we can watch it, follow it for a while, eventually most of them need to come out. That's all for this head and neck case number 8. Thank you for your attention and good luck on your board exam.